Random House Audio presents Waking Up in the Land of Glitter by Kathy Cano-Murillo. Read for you by Julia Whelan. 1. Hello, Arizona. Crafty Chloe Chavez here, braving the heat in front of La Pachanga Eatery with your weather update. It's already 98 degrees on this otherwise lovely Phoenix August morning, and it is time to break out the ice cubes, because we'll hit 110 by this afternoon. Coming up after the break, why was this beloved local business a target of vicious vandals?
You can't go on live TV with blood on your arm. Our viewers are eating breakfast,
the cameraman said, nodding at Star's elbow as he hoisted his equipment up on his shoulder. Crap, Star whispered before she licked her finger and scrubbed off the stain. I wish it was blood, she mumbled while standing in the parking lot of her parents' restaurant.
Don't be so nervous. You'll do fine, he said.
I'm far from fine this morning, but I'll deal. And for the record, it's not blood, just a smidge of spray paint.
Spray paint? He repeated, his attention piqued.
Hey, Star chirped. Speaking of blood, by any chance, do you knit? Star set aside the current troubles on her mind to enthusiastically explain the blood to knitting transition. See, I've been working on this high-impact art project, the Victims of Violence Blanket. It is dedicated to those who have been wrongly hurt all across the world. I want to get as many people as possible to help create a ginormous knitted blanket to represent our unified offerings of comfort and warmth. I feel that if we all just came together in the name of peace and love...
I don't knit, he deadpanned, cutting off her passionate plea. You're live in less than 3 minutes.
Star shoved her arm into her limited edition Tokidoki messenger bag that was slung across her chest and fished for her cherry lipstick. It's totally cool if you don't know how, she said as she retrieved it. She whisked the color across her mouth and then wiped the sweat from her neck with her other hand. It's not about technique or even knitting itself. It's about the intention. Each stitch is original and represents that person's energy. That's what makes it art. Art that matters. Not silly crafts that Crafty Chloe does. The Victims of Violence Blanket Project could change the world.
We're outside, sweating like pigs in a sauna, and you're talking about knitting? At least it's for a good cause. Almost done?
Actually, I haven't started. I don't know how to knit either. I'm more of a visionary type. She raised a fist, shrugged, and grinned. But I have hope. All I need is to find the right person to partner with, and I'm on my way. Star mentally congratulated herself for being so perky and positive, despite her current off-color condition, which consisted of a guilt-ridden hangover and 87 minutes of half-sleep. Who was she kidding? Every time someone cornered her, she changed the subject to an endearing topic. It served as her cutesy defense mechanism. The cameraman didn't find her cute. He appeared as if he wished he had taken the evening shift, where they cover stories like trials, riots, murders, and football games, or any combination thereof.
Live in 1 minute. Can you harness that hair? He barked. Chavez is territorial about her screen time, and your head'll take up more than half the shot.
Sure. Hey, has anyone ever told you that you look like that actor Ving Rhames? He ignored her. Rude, Star thought. That was a compliment. Ving Rhames rocked. Hello, Pulp Fiction? Even if this man knew how to knit, she didn't want his grumpy vibes woven into her blanket. She grabbed a stray lock that hung over her face and used it to tie back her curly mane, which hadn't been tamed since the day before. Meanwhile, a concerned crowd gathered in the parking lot to witness the damage to the property. Star looked at them and bowed her head.
Oh, God. This is really
truly happening. Suddenly, the magnitude of last night's crime sank into her gut and, even worse, her conscience. She bit her lip, looked to the sky, and chanted a power prayer seconds before she would lie to thousands of TV viewers across Arizona. Star kept her knees in locked position as she stood in front of La Pachanga, Phoenix's most famed Mexican restaurant, adored by art enthusiasts, culture hounds, visiting celebrities, and wealthy folks in Hummers looking for a dash of instant culture. Chloe's chubby, red-haired assistant powdered the reporter's satiny cheeks. She then whipped out a toothbrush, spritzed it with hairspray, and used it to smooth the cone-shaped crown of the reporter's stick-straight, frosty blonde hair. She then gave her shoulder-length tresses a heavy coat of spray. The Arizona sun was beyond hardcore. Star had lived in Phoenix all her life and still couldn't adjust to the summer temperatures, which included driver's arm sunburn and the melting of sentimental mementos, most recently a memory stick with all her favorite French pop songs. She inspected crafty Chloe's flawless appearance and wondered how, even without the touch-up, she could look so fresh in a long-sleeved suit standing in direct sunlight. There wasn't a drop of sweat on her, whereas Star could feel her own t-shirt damp on her back. Then again, crafty Chloe wasn't the one in the karmic hot seat. Chloe stepped next to Star and gave her a courtesy smile, trailed by a horrified sneer at her hair. Star bypassed the visual insult and gulped back tears of shame as Chloe began the interview.
"It's a sad day for Phoenix's art community," Chloe stated, somber, as if she were covering war in the Middle East. "In the darkness of the night, vandals ruined the award-winning mosaic mural here at La Pachanga Eatery, with, of all things, spray-painted happy faces. Local artist Theo Duarte garnered national attention when he created an ornate replica of the Sonoran Desert. Using only pebbles and river rocks from Arizona locations, the neighborhood-funded project that took more than a year to complete was heartlessly defaced in one night." Star's head throbbed, cottonmouth set in, and she became dizzy. She focused on a tan chihuahua across the street, joyously lapping water from a lawn sprinkler. She wished she could be that dog right now.
"I have with me Star Esteban, daughter of La Pachanga's owners," Chloe announced to the viewers of Wake Up Arizona.
"You look absolutely devastated, Star. What does your family make of this atrocity?"
Chloe scrunched her brows together, as all dedicated reporters do. She shoved the cordless handheld mic to Star's mouth.
Estrella Star Esteban considered herself a worldly girl. But this morning, no goddess, saint, healer, shaman, or even Nana Esteban in heaven could repair the anarchy she had ignited last night. Star cleared her throat, knowing her disappointed parents watched from home. Even worse, Theo had just walked up and stood a few feet away, his art repair caddy in tow. Several patrons patted him on the back to show their sympathy. He shook their hands and graciously thanked them. Theo must have sensed Star's pain because he offered her a smile and two thumbs up for support. Poor guy had no idea about the knife sticking out of his back. Like a pirate on the edge of a plank, Star prepared for the death plunge. She gripped the bottom of her glittered El Corazon shirt, inhaled, and went for it.
"No, Chloe, unfortunately, we have no idea who would have committed such a cruel act. It's such a horrible shame," Star replied with so much false confidence she almost believed her own lie. "But we are a loving family and we'll get through it. Regardless, our award-winning menudo is still just $1 a bowl until noon." Chloe paused and tilted her head, confused, then went on.
As you can see, the crime hasn't even sunk in yet to this emotionally exhausted girl, Chloe said, yanking the microphone away. She appeared irritated by the spontaneous sales plug, though she attempted to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.